Welcome, everyone. Welcome. I didn't think we could top last year's attendance at Professor Doumont's talk, but it looks like we have. And so please come forward. There are some reserved seats up here. There are some seats there as well. Make yourselves comfortable. Okay, wonderful. Well, welcome, everyone. My name is Dori Allen, and I direct the program in oral communication at the Center for Teaching and Learning. And this is a wonderful event today. I have the pleasure of introducing Jean-luc Doumont, who for over 20 years, in four languages and on five continents, has been training scientists, engineers, and other rational minds, as he puts it. To communicate more effectively. He has a degree from Louvain School of Engineering and also a PhD in applied physics from Stanford, so he's coming home. And he has the rare understanding of not only substance, grounded in his academic background, but also style as well. And in my work in oral communication, I'm often quoting him because he does bring together and coalesce content, design, and delivery in such a marvelous way. And so we're very lucky today. He's going to be talking about creating effective slides. But I would urge you, if you're interested in looking at this in a broader context, to look at his book. Did you bring copies? Today, Trees, Maps, and Theorems, Effective Communication for Rational Minds. So please help me welcome Jean-luc Doumont. Thank you.
You may have seen this classic cartoon, now almost 10 years old, in which the devil himself is interviewing a candidate for a job in hell, and saying, I need someone well-versed in the art of torture. Do you know PowerPoint? And I bet all of you here are frequently being tortured yourselves in this way in meetings or perhaps at conferences. Presentation slides, and PowerPoint in particular, have been the subject of heavy criticism over the years. And perhaps the most vocal of those critics has been graphics guru Edward Tufte, who even published a booklet called The Cognitive Style of PowerPoint, in which he goes all the way to saying that PowerPoint is making us stupid. He also says that you should not trust any speaker who is using slides. So much for me today, right? So in the response to the booklet that I published, I tried to be a little more nuanced, and despite what the cartoon might suggest, I believe that slides are not all evil. At the same time, I must admit that I share Tufte's frustration. If you ask me, most slides out there are highly ineffective. They detract from what the presenter is saying instead of enhancing the presentation the way you would expect. You want a reasonably random sample of such slides? Well, just yesterday, I did a Google search on the Stanford website asking for PowerPoint files and not specifying any particular keyword, and I just took the first 10 results. Those PowerPoint files had between 9 and 64 slides, and that was a total of 334 that I had to look at just yesterday. Relax, I'm not going to expose you to those 334 slides just right now. Let me show you a sample of 9 out of those slides. What do you think, for example, of a slide like this? Isn't this great? Is there anyone in the room who actually feels like reading this? I hope not, because if some of you are reading this slide, they are not listening to what I'm saying right now. Verbal communication, as you probably know, is sequential, one thing at a time. We cannot read text and listen to text at the same time. It's one or the other. And of course, that is a problem here. The very tight font, the direct line spacing that you have here for the size of the font does not help. The clip art is only marginally relevant to what this slide is trying to tell you. Oh, have you noticed this? The first line that sticks out like that, this is so typical. PowerPoint expected a bullet, right? And if you deprive PowerPoint of its beloved bullet, it starts acting up. For example, sticking things in the margin like that. So if you ever have that kind of issue, here is the tip. Keep the bullet. Make it the same color as the background. So only you and PowerPoint will know that there is a bullet. PowerPoint will be happy it's got its bullet. You will be happy because the bullet will be invisible to the audience. That would be the solution, of course, in this case. So you don't want a lot of text, huh? Maybe you would like something slightly more visual, something like this, for example. Now, even yesterday, alone in my hotel room, I had a hard time trying to absorb all the complexity of this diagram. I think what a diagram like this says to the audience is pretty much nothing else than, hey, the science analysis we do is really complicated. And if that's the message, fine. If not, well, you would have an issue. And I must say, in my experience, slides like this one are extremely frequent. One of those slides even made General McChrystal say, well, when we understand this slide, we'll have won the war. And that was reported by the New York Times about 3 years ago in an article titled, "We Have Met the Enemy," and it is PowerPoint. So you don't want a complicated diagram either, huh? Oh, I know what you need. How about mathematics? Is this helping? If I show you this slide for 3 seconds and remove it, will you have gotten something out of it? Or don't get me wrong, as an engineer, I strongly believe in the power of mathematical notations. But represented in this way, they are really hard to make sense of. There is no visual link between those various equations and the diagram. That is just not helping. And of course, some of the font is way too small up there. Question is always the same. If the audience needs it, then set it large enough so they are able to read it. And if the audience does not need it, why is it on the slide then? So this one is probably a lot better already, huh? Far less text all over the place. Yes, the font in the screenshot is still a little too small. You could solve that issue by zooming in on the top left corner of the screen, perhaps. Now, the question is this slide useful? First of all, it says everything twice. Have you noticed? Favorite and PeopleSoft menus, favorites and PeopleSoft menus. Click the favorites of PeopleSoft link to see the menu. Click the favorites of PeopleSoft link to see the menu. Everything is there twice. And even apart from that, as a second point, this content is really kind of obvious, isn't it? This slide was created in 2012. Well, I take it that most people in 2012 would know that if you want to see the menu, you have to click on it, and then the menu comes. So a question is the usefulness. Same question for this one here. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm sure that this slide has a lot of information that is useful for, I imagine, students, especially this URL, right? We'll email you a link as soon as it's ready and before next week. But do you think that students would like to have this projected on a screen? What are they supposed to do? Copy it like monks in the Middle Ages? Oh, perhaps this is not really a slide, huh? Perhaps this is really a handout, something that was distributed. But then the question is, why was it created in PowerPoint? Is that the best tool if you want a handout? I wouldn't be sure. At any rate, this is a bulleted list. The stereotypical way of organizing content in PowerPoint. Are lists a good idea? Well, sometimes yes, but maybe not that often. Oops. Make sure you click on the right one. Thank you. Now, look at this one here. Is this a list? Well, it certainly looks like one because you've got 6 bullets. But take a closer look. Is this really a list? Are these items forming a consistent whole? Certainly not to me, especially the last two ones here. There's a lack of parallelism in this list in terms of contents. This one is a lot more parallel, all the way to grammatical parallelism. See, except the one here in the middle, it's each time a verb in the imperative mood. Now, does that mean this list is working? It's a touch long, perhaps, huh? Now, you tell me, how many items do we have in this list? Can you say that without counting? Because that would be the idea. Visual communication, and that's the idea of a bulleted list, right? It's visualizing the structure. Visual communication is global. You see, and immediately you go, oh, I see. You can't do that if you have to count how many items there are. So what would be a practical limit on the number of items you can put in a bulleted list? Well, your intuition probably suggests 5. You enter a room, there are 4 people, immediately you go 4. You don't have to count. If there were 7 people, you would have to count. Unless they are grouped. Unless you have 3 there and 4 there. So what's the solution when you have 12 things to say, such as here? Group. Make a hierarchy of the information, a list of lists in a sense. Of course, don't take that idea to an extreme, right? 1, 2, 3, 4 different levels, that's too many already. 2 levels maximum, that's plenty. So take this one. 1, 2, 3, 4 items, 1 level. That should work, right? The list is not too long now, but perhaps the items in the list are on the long side. Here's a very practical rule of thumb. The audience will spontaneously read text items on 1 or perhaps 2 lines. But if it's 3 lines, they have to make a conscious decision to read. I can't really explain this short cutoff, but I observe it time and again. 2 lines is okay. 3 lines is already 1 line too many. So in the workshops that I run on oral presentations and on slides, people have to send slides in advance. I make a selection. We look at them just like we're doing now. But the group is criticizing the slides. And in this case, the author of the slide might defend himself, saying, oh, you're saying it's too much, but people don't have to read everything. That's why I put some of those words in red. Right. Well, 2 things about that. First, if we're only supposed to read what's in red, why do you put the rest on the slide? Second, even so, I don't find that the red words on their own make any sense. Just read them. Seller and buyer, budget, utility functions, goods, equilibrium, maximal clears. Does that make a sentence to you? Could you even make a sentence with all those words in it? I'm not sure. So even this is perhaps better than what we have seen before, but not the solution. Surely, we can do better than that, and this is what this presentation is all about, of course. Admittedly, I was selective in what I've been showing you, even though I think it's representative. One bias in particular, these were only PowerPoint slides, and there is more to the world of slides than PowerPoint. There are other tools, possibly better than PowerPoint, as long as you master them. But this presentation is not about tools. It's not about PowerPoint in particular, it's about slides. It's first of all about designing slides. What kind of content should you, or what kind of content should you not include on slides? That's an important first point. Once you know what to include, make sure you include it in a way that works well, in a way that enhances the presentation and does not distract from what the speaker is saying. And once we've got the slides we think we need, we should not forget the fact that slides are not a goal in themselves. They are there to support the presentation, not, as we will see, the other way around. So, how do I know that the advice I'm going to give you actually works? Well, perhaps because I've been doing it myself for more than 25 years successfully. Perhaps also because I've been running several hundreds of those interactive workshops with engineers, scientists, managers, and others. And each time, as a group, we would always converge on the same guidelines in the end. And as was mentioned before, and as you may have seen in the little piece of paper you got when you got here today, There are resources online. This is the URL that you can follow. You will find there the summary of the book, Trees, Maps, and Theorems. I also encourage you to look at this little booklet that you can download in PDF from the website. This is about resistance to change, something that we are going to discuss as well at different moments in the presentation. Traditions, templates, and group leaders, my three enemies in life. So before we jump into the design, something that may sound like a reminder to anyone who's been hearing some of my presentations before, we need an overall objective. If we want to optimize slides, we need to know where we want to get. If we don't have an objective, we cannot devise a strategy. When I ask my training participants, what is good communication? Invariably, they tell me, good communication is getting the message across. And for them, that means understand the message. I need to push them a little bit to realize that we first have to make sure people pay attention. And even understanding is not the end of the story. Usually, we want them to do something with the content we are communicating to them. In getting the message across, this is getting across. Next question, what's a message? Is it the same as information? Nope. It's a question of definitions, of course, but we usually agree that the message is the interpretation of the information. It is saying what the information means for a specific audience, for a specific purpose. So if information is the answer to the question, what, for researchers, what did you find in your research, then the message would be much more the answer to the question, so what? Well, what about it? What does it mean? What's your point? Why is it worth even talking about it in a presentation? Make sure you get the so what across in your presentation, and in particular on your slides. All the more difficult, of course, for high-density presentations like you have at scientific conferences. You go to a conference, you are going to present a whole year of research. And how much time do they give you for that? 10 minutes, 15 if you're lucky. What do you do in those cases? What you always do in life in such cases, optimization under constraints. Try to get a maximum of messages across. No, I insist on getting across, right? This is not trying to write as much as possible on your slides. This is trying to make sure that the audience gets as much as possible out of your slides. And as you may have realized with our examples today, the paradox of this is that maximizing what the audience gets out of it requires strict selection. You put too much, people don't absorb anything. They just stop looking at the slide altogether, so we'll have to be extremely selective. Rule number zero, make sure you have messages. If I say rule number zero, well, you can expect more rules. Yep, one morning I woke up and I thought, wait a minute, we've got the three laws of Newton for mechanics, we've got the three laws of thermodynamics, we've got the three laws of robotics, we need three laws of communication, and we can derive them on the basis of a simplistic model. Me, the channel, my audience. Want to optimize? Make sure you spend your time and effort on those variables that you can vary. If it's a given, don't waste time on it. And most of the time, the audience is a given. They may not have the background that you dream they would have. Nothing you can do about that, just magically. What can you choose? What you say? How you say that? That is where you have to optimize. The first rule of communication is the most obvious one, but perhaps the most difficult one in practice. Adapt to your audience. As I like to say to my students in the workshops, communication is not about you, it's about them. Easy to forget for slides. You know what strikes me in every interactive workshop when we look at the participants' slides? It's this huge difference between how much they think is too much on their own slides and how much they think is too much on other people's slides. And when other people criticize their slide, they say, oh, it's still too much? But you don't realize how much I've been removing already. Yep, it's about the audience. Stop thinking like a speaker when you have to give a talk. Start thinking like an audience. This, by the way, and don't anybody get offended, is one reason why your PhD advisor may be the worst person to give you advice on how to give your talk at conferences. They think how they would give the presentation if they were the speaker. but they're not. You have to think how the audience wants to receive the presentation. This is the only rule we would need in a perfect world, where we put the message on the left, it arrives on the right untouched. Practice not so. Lots of things can happen along the way that you could designate with just one word: noise. Anything that distracts. What would be noise on slides? Well, background colors, logos, too small font, too much text, you name it. But perhaps the worst of them all would be anything that moves. Transitions and special effects. Example, you've got three equations, and you want to show the first two first, and you would like the third one to appear afterwards. That's fine. Except, of course, if you make it appear from above, and it comes by doing bong, 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 bong. You must have seen things like that, huh? Why do speakers do that? Well, the first answer is what I like to call an Obama answer. Yes, we can. It is possible to do that with PowerPoint, so we do it. But if I push the speakers a little bit more, they have a loftier answer. They say, oh, but I'm trying to get the attention of the audience. And do they get the attention of the audience? Oh, yeah. On the wrong thing. No one in the room is thinking, how did she derive that third equation? Everyone in the room is thinking, how did she make that third equation bounce like that? Can I do that in my own slideshow, I wonder? Visible technology is noise. You know, I'm actually old enough to remember the very first laser pointer. If you know anything about lasers, that was a helium neon laser. Vacuum tube, high voltage capacitor, the whole thing was this long. When I was using it, no one was looking where I was pointing. Everyone was looking at the pointer. And I could see them in front of me going, it's a laser. Hey, look, it's got a laser. It's a laser. Visible technology is noise. Good technology is invisible. You don't notice it's even there. Criticizing is fun, huh? What do we do about noise? Easy. Put a filter. Filter out the noise. But there's another action we could take if there is some residual noise. Increase the signal. I'm sure some of you have seen this one before. Maximize the signal-to-noise ratio. If it's useful, make it stronger. If it's useless, reduce it as much as possible. There is nothing in between. Nothing in communication is neutral. People see everything. People hear everything. If they waste time processing something on your slide that is not useful, they are not using that time processing the message. As simple as that. Powerful rule for slides. You can improve your slides so much just by cutting out the noise. So why do we need a third law? Well, because you cannot always anticipate noise. In a session such as this one, even an hour like we have now, even if I try to have a high signal-to-noise ratio, I bet each of you, at different moments, you'll be thinking of something else. It happens, it's normal, it's perhaps even because of something I've said. Net result, there is a loss. I'll try to minimize that, but it will still happen. What can I do to compensate for the losses? Well, perhaps use some sort of redundancy. Example, right now I'm talking to you, I'm projecting slides. If you do not understand what I'm telling you, or perhaps because of my supposedly charming accent in English, then hopefully you understand the slides. And conversely, if you do not understand my slides, hopefully you understand what I'm telling you. I've got two chances. That's redundancy. Now, why do I call it effective redundancy? Well, because writing everything that I say on my slides would also be redundant, but it would not be effective. We don't want the slides to be noise for the spoken components of the presentation and vice versa. How can it be more complementary? Well, this is a drawing. I cannot say a drawing. I can say something that would be enough for you to understand, but it would not be a drawing. There is some complementarity. This is the strongest reason to use slides, in particular for the researchers in the room. Have you ever thought our conference presentation is the worst speaking situation possible? As if it wasn't bad enough that everyone presents a year of their life in 15 minutes, you have in front of you people who have traveled, usually. They are jet-lagged, sleep-deprived, underfed, and they thought there would be breakfast at the conference, but there wasn't. You put them in a room without windows for hours on end, your presentation, maybe the 17th presentation for them on that day, and they are not even native speakers of English. Expect losses. Expect lots of losses. The strongest you can do is make slides that compensate for that. So in essence, what we are saying is someone deaf should be able to understand your messages, not all the details, the messages, just by looking at the slides. Conversely, someone blind in the room should be able to understand the messages just by listening to you. Do you always have to make slides this strong? Not necessarily. It depends on the density of information you have, but you've got a difficult situation. This is the strongest you could do. So how do you do that? How do you design slides? Or perhaps let's start with how do you not design slides? You know what the mystery is for me? When I ask people what is wrong with slides, everyone, all together, they tell me, oh, easy. Too much stuff on the slide, and in particular, too much text. I agree 100%. The mystery to me is this. If everyone seems to know this, then why do we still see so many presentations with too much text? Oh, I can think of a number of answers. First, and I get some speakers to confess, they did the slides for themselves as a way to remember what to say, as a cheat sheet. I don't think you should need notes, but if you do, have notes. Just don't show them to the audience. They are your notes. Second reason, and I don't see this too much in academia, but it's a real problem in the business. People do slides that are supposed to double up as the written report. And that's too much stuff for good slides and too little stuff for a good report. In academia, people usually have the decency to write real papers and then make real slides, at least for research. Teaching may already be a different situation. But the strongest reason is the third one, and one example of it that I bet many of you have seen before is at a conference, a slide that has a table with 17 columns, 23 lines, and the speaker actually looks at you in the eyes and seriously tells you, I know this is too small for you to read, but if you look here, you will see. And of course, you don't see anything because it's too small for you to read. So I challenge these people, and I tell them, oh, come on. If you know this is too small for the audience to read, why do you even show this? And then they tell me, I know, it's not a very good slide. But you have to understand, I'm a busy person. I didn't have much time to prepare this presentation. It so happens I had the table in my paper, and I did copy paste. Major problem, if you ask me, is just slides done in a hurry, which usually means copied and pasted from somewhere else. Now, these same people, they go on to tell me, look, I know it's not a very good slide, but hey, it's better than nothing, right? And at this point in the presentation, you can probably guess what I answer. Wrong! A bad slide is worse than no slide at all because it's noise. So I know it sounds crazy in the 21st century, but let me be very strict on that one. There is no excuse for bad slides. No excuse. If you have the time to do them well, do them well. If you don't have the time to do them well, I understand. Oh, my life is pretty hectic as well. But then don't do slides. You know, let me share with you a memory I have from my graduate days in this university, and you can tell me if you can relate. It was 9 in the morning. There I was, happily working on the computer in the lab. My PhD advisor barges in and says, oh, by the way, I forgot to tell you, but we have visitors today. Would you give a short presentation about your latest research at 1 o'clock? See you then. Sounds familiar? It's 9 in the morning. You have to prepare something for 1 in the afternoon. What do most people do to prepare? They run to old sets of slides. They frantically pull slides from old presentations, organize them a little bit. They might add a few quick and dirty ones. And when they have a huge stack of slides, they go, ah, I'm ready. And what I recommend you do is everything except that. It's 9 in the morning. You have to have a presentation ready for 1 in the afternoon. Forget about slides. Forget it. You don't have time, and you have other priorities. If you've ever heard me give the presentation on how to give a full presentation, you would know those priorities. 1, planning. Before your boss runs away, you grab him or her by the sleeve and say, whoa, wait a minute here. I will give this talk at 1 o'clock, yes, but you tell me first. Who is coming at 1 o'clock? How many people? What kind of people? What do they want from us? What do we want from them? How much time should I be speaking? Which room is the presentation taking place in? Blah, blah, blah. All the planning questions. Next step, content. Structure. Take a blank sheet of paper. And if you follow my model, you would write on the left, attention getter, need, task, main message, preview, the main points for the transitions, review, conclusion, and close. And you fill in the blanks. Not with the text of your talk, with the idea. What's the problem I'm working on? What's my approach? What's my main message, the one thing I want the audience to remember? How do I make that clear to them? How do I prove my point? Use the back of the sheet if you want, but 1 sheet of paper. That's your preparation. You ready with this? And it's not 1 o'clock yet? Practice. Practice at least once. Practice to see how long it takes. Practice also to see if you master the vocabulary, whether it be the technical terms of your field, or just the English, if that's not your native language. If you practice once, you can still look up what you are missing. Slides are not the presentation. I've seen great presentations without slides. In fact, it may come as a shock to the younger persons in the room, but humankind has been giving presentations without slides for millennia, successfully so. But if you want the presentation to be good, it's got to be well-planned, well-structured, and well-delivered. Those are your priorities. Slides are not. Slides are redundant, right? Usefully so, but optional then. Now, don't get me wrong. If you have the time, do slides. Slides are great for reasons of effective redundancy. 1 message per slide would be the idea, and that suggests do the content first, as we've just said. You've got your main message divided into main points. You've got sub-points. At the level of the sub-point, 1 message, 1 slide, 1 slide, 1 message. For each sub-point, figure out the so what, and then get the so what across with your slide. How so? Well, here's perhaps the main idea for designing slides. Imagine at some point in the presentation, I'm discussing this graph. Where can you express the message? Well, the message is the most important thing, right? So put it in the most visible part of the slide, and that would be the title area there. Maybe we should stop calling that a title, but at least that area is traditionally called the title area. That's something people typically read. Let's get the message across. Is that what people do? I wish. Look at this graph. Ask someone to put a title on top of that. A classic would be a structure title. Point 3 result, 1 of 6. Next slide is about a totally different graph. It will say again, point 3 results. Only difference will be 2 of 6, 3 of 6, and so on. So if you push them a little bit and say, OK, this title is supposed to be in relation to the graph, what would they put? The what, not the so what. Evolution of the number of candidates, 1989-2012. What is this title telling you that you did not already know by looking at the graph? This is exactly the same as putting on your slide, say, a photograph of a mouse, and putting as the title of your slide, mouse. Or perhaps, photograph of a mouse, you know, just to make sure. And everyone goes, well, of course it's a mouse. What's your point? So instead of expressing the what, my strongest recommendation about the design of slides would be express the so what. What's your point? That we had a peak in 1997, that we had a dip between 2 peaks in 2003, or perhaps, as it was the case in this presentation, that the number of candidates dropped alarmingly over the last 4 years. You read this title, now you look at the graph differently, because you know what you're supposed to go looking for in that graph. So the idea is as simple as that. What's a slide? State your message. Have you noticed? It's a full sentence. Subject and verb. You want a statement, you need a full sentence. And after you state, you develop visually as you can. Still, as you do, you need to be careful the way you construct your slide. So let's go through another typical example. Here's a slide that is so representative of what I see at conferences. What do you have in there? Well, a little bit of everything. You've got a list with items that are parallel neither in content nor in grammar. You've got a footer, you've got a title on the blue band, and you've got a graph that pretty much exhibits everything that can go wrong with a graph. You just have one line and one set of dots. Why is the line dashed and why are the dots empty? The separate legend is a bad idea. The vertical text is hard to read. The horizontal scale is hardly intuitive. 0, 80, 160, 240, 320. The vertical scale has got too many numbers. The grid is useless. This is not about reading of values. This is about seeing the match between the experiment and the prediction. How come we have slides like that? Well, it all starts, unfortunately, with a very noisy template. That's the template. People will tell you, well, of course, you need the logo. Then you need to say what the presentation is. Oh, you need to repeat the date, huh? Because people are so jet-lagged, they may not know what day is today. And then you have to have a slide title. And that already uses a lot of space. But for many people, that's obvious. Hey, you have to say which company you're from. Right. So you've got those templates that overcrowd the information. That makes bad slides, hence bad presentations. But at least you are sure that everyone will remember from which company this bad presentation is coming. Your priority is and should remain give the best talk possible. So what's a template, really? A template is not a logo and a footer and a blue band that wastes so much space on top of that. A template is a way to specify where the content should come and how the content should look once it comes there. That means, as long as you don't have content, there should be nothing. It's about formatting content. This is all non-content. That's the first problem. The rest is the usual way people use the tool. They start with a bulleted list, and then they say, well, you know, I should put the graph, and so once the graph comes, it suffocates the slides, and the bulleted list is squished there on the right. And then the last thing they think of is a title. And with a space as tight as you have there with the blue band, of course you are going to say the what as opposed to the so what. You don't have enough space. Better than that, start with a template that does not give non-content. So when you start, it looks like this. Or you may have placeholders, of course, that may or may not be visible depending on the tool you use, but it's about what you put. How do you start? Not from a graph, from a message. First thing you should think of is, what am I trying to tell people? And the example I've just shown you, it was not on the slide, but it was in the paper where this slide comes. It was about saying that the conversion approaches 100% for high enough pump intensity. You put the so what in the title, a full sentence. If you've got a good sentence, it's worth displaying it in a way that will make the audience want to read it, that will enable the audience to read it fast. So centered is not a good idea. To read faster, you need to be able to start everywhere, every line from the same place, left a line. And if I left a line here, you notice we still have a long line and a short line, and especially a bad line break. Think about it. Pump intensity is on line two only because the software ran out of space on line one. That is not a very strong reason to go to a new line. Let's try to balance the lengths of the line, but especially, let's try to keep together what goes together. High enough goes together with pump intensity, so this would be a better way to cut your title. It's hardly extra work. It's just putting a return in there. It's worth it. All the line breaks by hand in visual media, in particular, slides. So this means we have a strong alignment axis here on the left. Anything you put on the slide could be aligned here on the left. Of course, if you have a bulleted list and the items are short, then everything would be on the left and the slide looks like it's imbalanced. So one recommendation I have without creating chaos is add perhaps a second alignment axis a little more to the right. For short items, you would align them here. So you'd have some blank space top right and bottom left, and the content kind of diagonal would be visually better balanced. Now, next thing you put is not a bulleted list. It's the visual part. It's the graph. Aligned right here, and not too big. Not something that suffocates the slides. Good. Now it's a question of signal-to-noise ratio. Horizontal scale, well, the one we had previously went from zero to something totally arbitrary. Let's try to have a reason for the second boundary of the scale. Well, somewhere in the bullets it said, above 500 megawatts per square centimeter, you get damage. So we could go all the way to 500 there. Have you noticed? Two values define an axis. We have no reason yet to put any tick mark or any additional value in between. That may come, but so far, no. Vertical scale, it's about approaching 100%, so yes, go from 0 to 100%. There you go, now you can put the data. You can specify on the graph itself that the blue line is not just a prediction, it's the prediction from the adiabatic model. Oh, you know what's a pity? It's about the line approaching 100% on the right, but it says 100% on the left. Or you could have a line on top of it. Perhaps in this case, you could put the vertical axis on the right. Good. Now, what about the bulleted list? Well, the first item said that the maximum power available, pumps intensity available, was 160. Well, show that on the graph. Put 160 on the graph, which means you can put pump intensity somewhere else and megawatt per square centimeter next to the number, perhaps. Second bullet was about wavelengths. This graph is not about the wavelengths, so it does not belong on the slide. You might mention the wavelengths. If you don't, be ready to provide them if somebody asks. Make sure you put them in the paper, in the proceedings. Not on this slide. It's not about the wavelengths. Third bullet was about the conversion value you reach at the maximum pump intensity, which was 75%. And the last bullet was about this damage threshold for the crystal at 500 megawatts per square centimeter. There you have it. Visual means every time you have to say something, say it in relation to what is already in the visual part of the slide, not a separate bullet list. Which means what we do here is much closer to working on the whiteboard than it is to writing a paper. This is not about written communication. On the whiteboard, you'd never make a bulleted list. You'd be there with your pen, making arrows and lines and connecting things visually. Well, that's exactly what we do here in a slightly neater way, perhaps, than on a whiteboard, but it's exactly the same idea. So where did the logo go? Well, it's gone. Let's go for the purpose. Why do you need a logo? It's not a goal in itself. It's because you want people to know which organization you're from. That's a valid purpose. Does that mean you need the logo on every slide? Of course not. Do you say your name at the beginning of every sentence as well, perhaps? Where do people want to know where you're from? At the beginning. So put the logo, beyond this, put the logo on the title slide, right here, under maybe the title of your talk, your name, the date, to show that it's really for them. That would be a good place. Perhaps at the end of the talk, they would like to know again or be reminded where you're from. I often reuse my title slide as a last slide. Otherwise, a nice thing you can do for questions and answers is saying, well, there's nothing relevant I could have on the screen for questions and answers. How about I use a wallpaper for questions and answers? Just this, a logo, not too big, not too small, that's there next to me while I'm answering questions. That's a strong corporate branding, but it's not noise. It's out of the way. Of course, people tell me, yes, but you are cutting corners here. The reason we have a footer with a logo, the title of the talk, the date, and everything, is because afterwards, when we give the slides, people have to know which presentation they are from. OK. Are you sure you want to give your slides? As we've said before, if it's something else than the presentation, maybe you want a real handout, a paper, a document in Word or tech or otherwise, something vertical as opposed to horizontal. But even if you give your slides, I'm not sure you want to give the slideshow. Think of it, if people print it, they would have to look at your slides like this, really, because the font is meant for a big screen in front of a big room, not for reading from close by. So if you give your slides, my recommendation would be don't give the slideshow. Give the thing that PowerPoint calls a handout. 6 slides per page. Wonderful test of readability. print your own slides before you give the talk, 6 per page. Anything on there is too small for you to read at that size, chances are it's going to be too small for the audience to read in a big room. Now, if you need legal information, like a copyright, or branding information, like a logo, put that in the handout, but outside of the slides. Above and below, have a strong template for your handout as well. And I would say then give this as a PDF, locked. It doesn't prevent skilled people from extracting information, of course, but it's a first precaution against people stealing the content of your slides. That would be a better approach. All right then, we've got better slides. Now we have to use them. Well, think about it. We said somebody deaf should be able to understand the messages just by looking at the slides. We've worked on that. There's the message, and if they don't believe the message, there's this illustration of the message under it. Now let's worry about the second half. Someone blind in the room is supposed to understand the messages just by listening to you. You have to work hard on your text as well for that purpose. So what I usually recommend is that, of course, you practice your presentation several times, but for this purpose here, that you practice your presentation at least once without your slides. Can you do that? All of you, think of the last presentation you gave. And imagine that just as you were starting, your computer dies. I did not say crash. I said die. It's gone. You don't have your slides. Would you have been able to give the talk? If yes, you're a speaker, a real one. If no, you are like most people today. You are a museum guide explaining paintings to the audience. Isn't it so at conferences? What you see are slide-driven presentations. People explain a slide to you. Worse, when they come to the bottom of the slide, they don't even remember what the next slide is. So they come to the bottom and they say to you, yep, I think that's all I wanted to tell you on this one. Then they go to their computer, they press the arrow key, they discover the next slide together with the audience. Then they try to remember what it is they wanted to say to you about it, and only then they speak. If that's the way you give presentations, how could you possibly have a transition? The whole idea of the transition is to anticipate on the next slide. You would wrap up the current one saying something like, well, these are the results we get at room temperature. Now the question is, does it still hold if we increase the temperature? Well, we made a second test. We repeated the experiment at 500 Kelvin, and now you press the arrow key, here comes the next slide. This is what we found. So the strongest you can do is know that you can give the talk without your slides if necessary. That will be so good for your nervousness. You can know that whatever happens to the technology, you can do it. Now, if that is too tough for you, or if it's too late, like it's the morning of your presentation, you are way past that kind of exercise, here's a simpler one. Sit in front of your computer with the first slide on and ask yourself, do I know what my second slide is? Press the arrow and check. And again, now you ask yourself, do I know what the next slide is? Do I know what the next slide is? Do I know what the next slide is? In other words, during the presentation, one quick look at the screen, the big projection screen or the small laptop screen, whatever, and you should immediately know what the next slide is. Be one slide ahead in your head compared to what is happening on the screen. That would be being in charge. That's a real presentation. You want something else about interacting with your slides? Have you noticed? I am pointing at my slides with my hand. My PhD here at Stanford was all about lasers. I love lasers. I would not use a laser pointer in a presentation. Why is that? Well, you probably have elements of answers yourself from sitting in audiences, right? If you have somebody using a laser, that little dot is all over the place. Unavoidably because of nervousness. Heck, even if you're not nervous. One day at home, after a big project, I was totally exhausted. I felt I could not even get up from my chair. And for some reason, my brain was not totally dead yet and started thinking, you know, today, your body is so quiet, I bet you can project your laser on the wall and it will be exactly where you want it. So I tried. Do you know what I saw on the wall? My heartbeat. That's the quietest I could ever get. But that's not even half of the problem. The real problem comes from the use of the laser. If I have a laser, I would probably have to stand somewhere here to point at the screen, right, with my back turned to part of the audience, or I would be here with a grazing angle of incidence, especially I'm disconnected from my screen. If I ever give you a longer presentation about the other aspects of speaking, I would insist on the importance of what I call impressing the audience with your body. And for that, they have to look at you. If I'm here, I point at the screen with my laser, all of you will go and see the screen. That's fine. If I release the button on my laser pointer, I bet everyone stays on the screen. I become a voice off, like in TV documentaries, right? You see the pictures, you hear the voice, not the same thing. Recommendation, come next to the screen. What's your priority during a talk? Eye contact. You know how important that is for credibility, right? When a child is telling you something and you think he or she might be lying, what do you tell the child? You say, look at me in the eyes when you say that. And that's when they go, yes, it's true. So look at the audience. Eye contact begins in the feet. You want to look at the audience, make sure you put your feet parallel to the audience. Not sideways, certainly not turning your back to the audience, facing. Now you just point at your screen with your hand and with your eyes. If I do that, you will go and look at what I'm pointing at. That I could do with a laser. What I could not do with a laser is bring you back. I bring my hand back, I bring my eyes back. Now you are all looking at me. Nobody is looking at the screen anymore, you on me. Whether you like it or not, I control what you pay attention to, in a sense. Of course, the screen is big enough that you cannot point all the way to the right. I have no problem myself, contrary to what some books might be telling you, I have no problem coming in front of the screen and pointing at things on the right if necessary. But notice, I am not looking at you. I will wait until I'm out of the slide to look at you again. Why so? Two reasons. First, if I'm in front of the slide and I look at you, I get a projector in the eyes. That's a strong reminder of the fact it's a bad idea. But it's worse. Imagine I come somewhere here. I probably have the legs of my little character there on my face. If I look at you, you're going to look at me and going to see noise on my face. If I point there and look there, I still have stuff on my face, I bet. But you're not looking at it. You're looking where I'm pointing. Of course, this room is designed the way I like rooms to be designed. I can be next to the screen. What if the screen is even bigger than that? Well, if you need to point with some technological device, instead of a laser pointer, I would still prefer a good old-fashioned stick. You would just point all the way to the top there with what is basically an extension of your arm, right? Something visible. Makes a visual connection between you and the object, and you can bring the attention of the audience back to you. Of course, you know what the problem is with a pointer, right? This is the problem with a pointer. People end up playing with their pointer, or standing on it, or becoming dangerous for the first row. So if you use a stick, a mechanical pointer, find some place around you where you can put it down when you don't need it. Only pick it up when you do need it. And I know some rooms will have the screen not only big, but high, and then even a stick won't do. What do you do then? Do you use a laser? Perhaps, but I wouldn't. Do you use the mouse of your computer? Perhaps, but I wouldn't either. Be defensive. If you think people will only get the point about a graph, for example, if you put your finger on one of the data points, put that kind of emphasis in your slides. Make sure the slides, again, get the point on their own. And then if the screen is way up there, the best you can do is send the audience to the screen with a flick of the hand. And yes, after that, you'll have to work harder to get the attention back on you. That's part of the job, however. Make sure you do what you have to do so they look at you. So there's more than creating slides, right? There's the way you use the slides during the presentation, when you change the slides and how you point at them. Good. We designed them. We constructed them. We know how to use them. Let's sum that up. What to remember about slides? Well, First of all, and let me insist again, do your slides right or don't do slides. I run workshops on slides, I told you, but I'm still someone who would love to see fewer but better slides in the world. I've seen so many presentations with absolutely awful slides and a speaker who had nothing to say about them and spent almost all of his speaking time apologizing because he was only warned the day before that he had to give a talk. And I was thinking, well, if instead of doing those horrible slides, you heads spend the same amount of time thinking of what it is you wanted to tell the audience, your presentation would have been so much better. Your priorities, plan the presentation, make sure it's appropriate, structure it, practice it so you can deliver well. If you do create slides, nothing wrong with that, of course, remember it's for getting the message across, so one slide, one message. State as a full sentence, subject verb, and then illustrate as visually as you can. I know that finding that sentence to put in the title area of your slide may be tough, but noticing that it's missing, that's easy. When you think your slides are ready, you just look at each of your slides. If the title is not a full sentence, fix it. Last recommendation, back to signal-to-noise ratio. If you've ever taken a writing class, you've heard about conciseness. Be concise on slides, but not just for the text. Be concise verbally and visually. Instead of thinking, what can I add to my slide, you should think, what can I remove from my slides, starting from the template. This is a tough one for speakers. If you've put something on your slide and later you have to remove it, this is like cutting a piece of your own finger or something. It's your creation. It's tough to alter it. So you need a motivation. Let me recommend for this last one here, my patent-pending M&Ms method. You know the M&Ms? Little chocolates? Well, put a bowl of them on your desk. Look at the draft of your slides. Every time you can remove something from a slide without loss of information, yes, you reward yourself by eating an M&M. So next time I come to Stanford, what do I want to see? Lean slides, and yes, perhaps slightly plump presenters. Now, all of this, doing all of this is going against the grain. Some of you are probably thinking right now, a presentation without slides, it makes a lot of sense, but I would never dare. Nobody does it. What would my boss think of that? Blah, blah, blah. So this is also all about encouraging you to be rebels. Don't do like other people do. Don't follow the masses because the masses are doing their slides wrong. Dare to innovate, dare to be different. Be a rebel, but for a good cause, right? Not just for the heck of it, for a good cause. Let me just close on that point. This presentation is all about changing the world one slide at a time. Thank you. All right, several things. A few next steps, see if there are questions, and then yes, you got a raffle ticket, we need to raffle off a copy of the book. Next step, remember to go get the stuff online. You've got a URL, go get it there, share it with the entire world, let's develop a critical mass. If you're interested in the book, you have a discount code on that piece of paper. It's valid for 2 weeks. Take advantage of that. And if you like visual stuff, fun visual stuff, then follow me on my Facebook page. I post lots of visual anecdotes each time with a learning point. Let me maybe limit the questions to one or two, not to keep you too long, and then we raffle the book. Who wants the first question? That would be you.
What are your thoughts on white and black?
Ah, yes. Do you want dark text on a light background, the way I do here? Or do you want light text on a dark background? Well, it's a tough issue. And I would say that the best recommendation is to make the background of the slide match the light in the room. This explains why there is a long tradition of doing dark backgrounds. Because the projectors used to be much weaker, we had to dim the lights in the room. And in a very dark room, a dark background is better. Nowadays, we have better projectors, light backgrounds are then better, and they are going to make your life so much easier when you copy and paste from somewhere else or when you print your slides. Perhaps the only people who still have a reason to use dark backgrounds because they are probably going to dim the lights would be the people who do a lot of fluorescence imaging. If that's your field, yes, to see something on your fluorescence images, we may need to dim the lights a lot more than today, and then maybe a dark background. But be ready for complications. You want to put a graph on that? It's not okay to put a big white rectangle on your dark background. You have to invert your graph as well. The background of the graph must be the background of the slide. That's a lot of work. Is this helping? One more question? Who wants the last word? Nobody wants the last word. That's amazing. Yes, that would be you.
What about slide numbers? You keep saying remove stuff, but people need to ask questions about certain things on your slides.
Yes, people need to ask questions about slides. So there is a definite advantage to slide numbers, and that would be that the audience can say, can we go back to slide 17? Why am I not putting slide numbers on my slides? Well, because there are also definite drawbacks to slide numbers. And it's a question of balancing advantages and drawbacks. What's the drawback? Well, in my experience, most people use slide numbers, most people in the audience use slide numbers as a way to evaluate how much longer they have to endure this ordeal. So this means it's only a drawback if it's a bad presentation. Now, if it's a good presentation, I find that almost nobody looks at the slide numbers because they're in the talk. In that case, I thought, well, the advantage is there, but it's minimal. The drawback is major. It's taking real estate on my slides. I don't want it. Of course, if you've got strong messages in the title area, then you are giving the audience another way to refer to your slides. Can we go back to the slide when you said the number of candidates was down dramatically? That's as easy as saying, can we go back to slide 17? Still, if you decide to put slide numbers on your slide, no objection. Perhaps the one time in your life that many of you would want to do so is for your PhD defense, because the jury love to say, can we go back to slide 17? If you do, make sure the slide number does not interfere visually. If you just come and put a number here in the corner, sooner or later, you'll have something here, and the slide number will look like it's part of the display. So the recommendation for slide numbers or anything else that's not the slide content would be, how about a band here at the bottom in a dark color, perhaps even black? And you put the slide number in there. Of course, it's a lot of space for just a slide number. But if you wanted to remind people of the structure of your talk and where we are, again, I don't think it's worth the real estate, but I have no objection if you do, you could put that down there. What will it look like on the screen? It will look like this information is, in fact, outside of the slide, which is exactly what you want. Then it never interferes with the content. Is this helping? Good. Now, anybody has drums? Classic approach. Give me a number between 0 and 9.
6.
6. Give me a number between 0 and 9.
4.
4. One more.
5.
5. 6, 4, 5. Is that the winning number? Of course not. It's the seed that I need for my random number generator, obviously. 6, 4, 5. Now, do you know how many tickets were given, Dory?
77.
So let's add 2 here. Ta-ta-ta-tum. Number 34 wins the book. Number 70 wins the booklet. Are those people still in the room? 70 is dead. We have 34. Congratulations. You win a book and a booklet. If you have more questions, come and talk to me after the presentation. I'm not running anywhere. If not, have a great afternoon.